all day. Our format is welcome, song, prayer, sharing, and comments are welcome. Just post them in there and closing. And the song is God So Loved. And actually, they sang it at my church last 2 weeks ago. So we can listen and then type done. like the invitation, bring all your failures, bring all your addictions, and lay them at the foot of the cross, because God did. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, to the end that all who believe in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. So, Father, we do just that. We come before you tonight, and we lay it all down. Whatever's going on in our lives, whatever went on even 5 minutes ago, whatever things we have hovering over us for the rest of the night, or like Nanny Dove, tomorrow and the next day, we don't know, but we do know who you are. And we know that you are good, and we know that you have good plans for us. We know that you see and that you care, that nothing that concerns us is too teeny tiny small or insignificant, and nothing is too big. And so, Father, we lay our cares down, and we open our hearts to receive in a fresh way tonight, a gift, whatever the gift is that you have for us through your word. In Jesus' name, amen. Okay. It's really funny because I don't type the prayer because I don't know what I'm going to say. last week, we had a lot of fun, I think. I found it fun. We use scripture truth to refute the lies that the enemy and often the world would have us believe are true about ourselves. There's lies out there that define our identity, but in truth, they don't. We might feel like, you might feel like, and sometimes probably all of us do at times, that you're rejected, you're unloved, or you're shameful even. And circumstances of life or even people may have led us to believe such a thing. That's a lie from the pit of hell. But the truth, according to God, by way of his word, the Bible, reminds us that we are accepted. That's what we talked about last week. We are completely, totally, irrevocably accepted by God. And it's not because of anything we do or do not do other than believe. But it's simply because we belong to God. So we are accepted and we have significance. And the reason is because of God. It's all God's doing. It's for God so loved the whole wide world. That includes you and that includes me. And it also includes our worst enemies. And as a quick review, these are the things we talked about last time. I'm going to just post them in. We're not looking up the scriptures. Okay, these are the things that we talked about last time in case you weren't here. And you can copy paste them and look them up if you want to. We are God's child. We are Christ's friend. We have been justified. We are united with the Lord, and we are one in spirit with him. We have been bought with a price, and so we belong to God. We are members of Christ's body. We are a saint, a holy one. And this one's hard, but think of it this way. Before we were born again, sinner was our identity. We were a slave to sin. But once we are born again, yeah, we still sin, but we have a brand new identity. We are saints who sometimes still sin, but our identity has been changed from sinner to saint. We have been adopted as God's children, and so we have direct access to God through the Holy Spirit. We have been forgiven of all our sins. And we looked at those in depth. Tonight, we are going to look at verses that remind us we are secure. We are secure because God, who is unchanging, is our security. Think about it. God, who is the same yesterday, today, tomorrow, and forever, he's our security. And so we're secure. There is a great story about a good dad crossing a parking lot with his child. And a pastor told this story, and it was a true story. He had, I think he had four little children. So his wife had two, and he had two when they were tiny, and they would park in the mall Remember when we had malls? And he'd park in the mall and they'd have to walk through that crowded parking lot with all those cars, say at Christmas time. And so he would say, now you got to hold my hand. The kids knew that. So each child would take one of the parents' hands. They had four hands, four children. So this little kid, the little boy, had a hold of his father's finger. He had his whole little tiny three-year-old fist wrapped around his daddy's finger. And he looked up his daddy with big love and really proud, like we do to God sometimes. And we say, I'm holding on real tight, daddy. And his father smiled back at him. He said, you sure are, son. But he told us what the little son didn't know was while he was holding his daddy's finger with his whole fist, his daddy had a death grip around his wrist and nothing was going to hurt him. I like that story. And so last week, I left off one of the scriptures that should have been in that list. And the statement is, we are complete in Christ. Did you know you're complete? You're complete in Christ. And the scripture is Colossians. It says, for in Christ lives all the fullness of God in a human body. So you also are complete through your union with Christ, who is the head over every ruler and authority. And notice, this being complete is God's work. It says, we are complete. It doesn't say try to be complete. It doesn't say when you get it right, you're going to be complete, or when you're perfect, or if everybody likes you, then you're complete. It says, we are complete through, because of our union with Christ. Do you ever, you don't have to tell us, you can just think to yourself, do you ever feel unwelcome? Perhaps we have been or even are still being rejected by family or people who matter to us. But you know what? God welcomes us, each of us. And we have, isn't that great? We have direct access to the throne of grace through Jesus Messiah, Jesus the Christ. Can you really wrap your mind around that? Can your heart, or does your heart need? Can your heart rest in the security that no matter what, we are welcomed into the presence of God? And you know what? We don't need a special pastor. But you're not, though, Nanny Dove. God has arms are open wide welcoming you, and he does not reject you. And yes, Psalmist, he predestined us to the adoption to himself as sons and daughters through Jesus Christ, according to the purpose of his will, to the praise of his glorious grace, which he has blessed us in the beloved. Beautiful passage. We don't need a special pastor. We don't need a prayer warrior. And we don't need a priest. We are invited to simply come. And you know what? Even when we mess up, which is also sin, if we have sinned, we are accepted in the beloved. I like that. If we have sinned, we do not need to run and hide like Adam and Eve did. It didn't work too well anyway, did it? We are invited and welcome to come. And when we do, we will find grace. Hebrews 4, 14 through 16 says, so then, since we have a great high priest who has entered heaven, Jesus, the Son of God, let us hold firmly to what we believe. There's that believe word again. Believe with your mind. Believe in your heart. Confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord and you will be saved. I'm starting over. I got distracted. Sorry. So then, since we have a great high priest who has entered heaven, Jesus, the Son of God, let us hold firmly to what we believe. This high priest of ours understands our weaknesses, for he faced all the same testings we do, yet he did not sin. So let us come boldly to the throne of our gracious God. There we will receive his mercy, and we will find grace to help us when we need it most. Isn't that a precious promise? We do have a part, which is to hold firmly. like that little boy was holding his daddy's finger as tight as he could, but daddy had a death grip on him. Of course, at times we waver, but we can pick up our Bibles, or we can just recall key verses, or we could listen to a song that speaks of the truth, and we can remember what we know but forgot. And it tells us, did you see that? The last part of that passage tells us Jesus understands our weaknesses. And it reminds us that we can come, we don't come crawling like a slug or a snake or something. We come boldly to Jesus to receive mercy and grace to help us when we need it most. Isn't that neat? And that was left over from last week. I made a mistake. Now this week, we're going to talk about our need for significance, okay? One of our needs given by God is a need for significance. We need to matter, and we need to know we matter, that we're important, and we are. We want to belong. We want to matter. We need a place to belong and a place to matter. And usually, our first place of belonging is our natural family, usually. But since we are human, and live in a fallen world among other fallen, not yet healed people, often we are severely wounded in our families of origin. And sometimes we're only just a little bit wounded, but nobody had perfect family. We may have even wounded others in our own families, our spouse, our children, or other relatives, or in the family of God, we may have wounded people. But we aren't stuck in our family of origin. We have another family, and that's the family of God. And it's a new family, and it's a huge family, where we are granted membership for life at new birth. God is perfect. Do you think his family's perfect? But again, this family, the family of God, is full of imperfect people like you and me. And so it's not perfect. So yes, we can be hurt, even within the family of God. Never, ever by God, but sometimes by our brothers and sisters. You may have been hurt by a church or pastor or someone in the family of God. So my question is, is your heart hurting? Maybe you were hurt in your family of origin, and I think to some extent we all have been. Have you hurt others? Probably yes, yes, yes. How about in the family of God? I remember a pastor told me when I was first born again, he said, you're going to be hurt worse than you've ever been hurt before by someone in the family of God. He says, if that happens, just remember that they are imperfect people. Maybe you've been hurt here in the family at Four Gospels, and we will be hurt. Sometimes things are done intentionally that hurt us. Yes, and it is hard to forgive ourselves. But if God says we're forgiven and we refuse to forgive ourselves, then we're calling God a liar. And we can't do that because we know he's not. And actually, we don't forgive ourselves. We receive God's forgiveness for ourselves. More often, things are done unintentionally, which hurt us. Most of the time, it's not done intentionally. It's unintentional. Sometimes it's done in total ignorance. Sometimes it's because of our own faulty perception, which happens when we use our hurts and pain to filter the actions of others. That's not coming up in mine. It's just spinning. And sometimes we do not have a clue why we are hurting. We're just hurting and we don't even know why. We don't know sometimes why we feel like we're not important, why we feel like we don't belong, or we feel like we don't matter. But tonight, we're going to share more about what God says about us. Is my am I still on or am I gone? Can y'all hear me? Okay, because that thing that Psalm has been is spinning and I didn't know if my internet was out. Here's what I want you to do. This is really important. Inside your own head or out loud if you're by yourself, you use your own name are significant. You can say, I'm significant. You matter. Let's see what God says about that in his word. So Christ's walk is significant and matters. I is significant and I matters. Lady is significant and lady matters. LDM is significant and she matters. Luana is significant and she matters. Mom is significant and she matters. Nanny Deb, you are significant and you do matter. Psalmist, you are significant. You do matter. Psalm of the violinist, you are significant and you matter. And Corndeo, you are significant and you matter. And you matter. You all matter to me. I like everybody that's in this place right now. We, thank you. We, I, are or am significant. We, you and I, are a branch of Jesus Christ, the true vine, and we are a channel of his life. And that is not a bad word. I'm going to explain it. We're not that kind of bad word channel. We're a conduit of his life. John 15:5 says, yes, I am the vine and you are the branches. Those who remain in me and I in them will produce much fruit. For apart from me, you can do nothing. So what if you imagine that you are actually a vine? You've seen a grapevine or some other kind of vine or even a weedy vine with many branches or a tree. And we imagine ourselves that closely and that vitally connected with Jesus because we are. And we can begin to grasp how much we really do matter. We are connected to and with Jesus himself. And he used the analogy of the vine to show that. So if you chopped off one of the branches of a vine or a tree, what would happen? It would die, right? There it is. Ooh, neat. There's the vines. Yeah, I've heard you have to really severely prune those grape vines for them to produce grapes. Mine grows wild and produces grapes. We must be connected to Christ. It is vital for a healthy life. A branch or root actually has a channel. If you ever, it's like a little straw. If you go study online the anatomy of a plant and how it moves water up and nutrients down through its branches and its roots and its trunk. And it actually has a channel, almost like a teeny tiny straw inside it for water and for nutrients to pass up and down. So we, just like the plant or the vine analogy in the Bible, we receive life by being connected to Jesus. We also receive nourishment whenever we read, ponder, or study the word. Yes, and fellowship, and there's a whole lot of other ways. I actually do it admiring God. I feel so close to God when I go up to the river or the lake or even out in my own backyard and look towards the woodsy area. Something about what God created is just so beautiful and perfect. We, you and I, have been chosen and appointed to bear fruit. John 15:16 says, and this is great, you didn't choose me, I chose you. I appointed you to go and produce lasting fruit so that the Father will give you whatever you ask using my name. Now, this is a verse I think sometimes we misunderstand. Some people teach that we can willy-nilly ask God for whatever we want, and God will be like a cosmic vending machine and spit it out. But the context here, yeah, I know that's not true. But the context here is produce lasting fruit. We ask what we need in order that we may bear fruit for God, fruit that honors God. And maybe that whole big topic, the cosmic vending machine, or the genie in the bottle, yes, and last. Maybe someday that would be a good topic, but for now we're going to focus on God chose every single one of us. We are chosen. And besides that, we, you and I, are God's temple. He doesn't need the temple in Jerusalem anymore because we're his temple. 1 Corinthians 3:16 says, "Don't you realize that all of you together are the temple of God and the Spirit of God lives in you?" For God's sakes. This lady's going to call me back and back. Hold on. I'm going to speak to her. I'll turn my mic off. So she hung up. Maybe she won't call back. I'm sorry. I lost my place. Yes, it does, lady. It makes it easier to love one another. I'm a lay prayer minister, and this lady must have a problem. I know who's calling me, but I can't deal with that right now. So I'm with y'all, and that's number one at the moment. So 1 Corinthians 3:16 says, "Don't you realize that all of you together," and lady, I hadn't caught that until when I read it earlier, getting ready for this, "all of you together are the temple of God and that the Spirit of God lives in you." We are significant, if for no other reason, that God's own Spirit lives in us. Imagine that. We are God's temple. We are his dwelling place. Others can look at our lives in our corporate life and see God himself shining through us. We are not God in no way, but we, just like the moon reflects the sun, we reflect, hopefully, the light of Christ. Yes, that's a great one. You also, as living stones, are being built up a spiritual house, a holy priesthood, to offer up spiritual sacrifice acceptable to God through Jesus Christ. And I don't know about you, but that being a temple of God to reflect him to the world around us seems like a really big deal to me. And that makes us significant. Without us being us. The next one is really nice. We are significant because we, you and I, are ministers of reconciliation for God. 2 Corinthians. Yes, living stones fitly framed together, forming the temple of God. 2 Corinthians 5:17-21, so it's a little bit long. I'm going to go put a little bit more in here so I don't. Thank you. 2 Corinthians 5:17-21. "This means that anyone who belongs to Christ has become a new person. The old life is gone and a new life has begun. And all of this is a gift from God who brought us back to himself through Christ. And God has given us this task of reconciling people to him. For God was in Christ, reconciling the world to himself, no longer counting people's sins against them. And he gave us this wonderful ministry of reconciliation." So, wait, it gets better. Look at this. "So, we are Christ ambassadors. God is making his appeal through us. We speak for Christ when we plead, 'Come back to God.' For God made Christ, who never sinned, Christ who knew no sin, to be the offering for our sin, so that we could be made right with God through Christ. Can you even take that in? Hi, Savon. Welcome. Let's reread that slowly. We are significant because we are ministers of reconciliation for God, meaning we can share and help others come to Christ, either for the first time for salvation or again and again for forgiveness of sin. It's pretty important, isn't that? Pretty significant. And that could just be one person at a time. And we often do that by simply being who God created us to be and allowing other people to see us repent and be restored when we sin, as well as forgiving others when they sin against us. And it also says in that same passage, we have a new life, not just once at new birth. Every single morning, every time we sin and turn and confess and return to God, it's new. All this is a gift from God. And it's a gift. I didn't mean to yell. All this is a gift from God, a gift which costs Jesus his very life. Do you think you matter to God? Do you think you're significant? Who's telling you the truth? Circumstances of life or God? And morning by morning, his mercies are new. And that's a song. Morning by morning, my mercies we see. God gives us a task of reconciling people to him. And what is that? What is that task? It means by our life, by our actions, by our witness, by our deeds, by our speech, our entire life, we can have the honor and joy of pointing to Christ. And will we fail? Of course. Yes, we will. Will we be hurt along the way? We surely will. And will we hurt others? Probably. Sadly, a lot more often than we want to. But even knowing all that, God just told us, and God has given us this task of reconciling people to him. For God was in Christ, reconciling the world to himself, no longer counting people's sins against them. And he gave us this wonderful message of reconciliation. And this is also, yes, this is also one of the reasons we are commanded. We're not asked, we are commanded to forgive those who wrong us. Lady said, and let us not grow weary of doing good, for in due season we will reap if we do not give up. And it says, whatever a man sows, that also shall he reap. I want to be sowing things like forgiveness and compassion and kindness and love. I don't want to sow that other stuff because I don't want to reap it. And Nanny Dove said, I've been told so much lately how bad a person I am. I'm beginning to believe it. Well, Nanny, you have a choice now. You can believe what God says, or you can believe what they say. You can believe what God promises, or you can believe the past. It's a choice. And that's not the only thing. That other word in there was ambassadors. And I put stars by this because it's important. Yes. We are called by God himself ambassadors. Wow, if no one else ever wants us or thinks we are significant or matter, guess what? God just called us ambassadors. Do you know what an ambassador is? He's a person like the United States has embassies in other countries, and they have ambassadors who are the like little rulers in the embassy, and that is considered a piece of America in whatever country the embassy's in, and the American rules apply in that piece of property, and the ambassadors have authority there. We are God's ambassadors everywhere we go, because God dwells within us. We take his light with us into the dark and hurting world around us. And they may not like it, but we do it anyway. So guess what? You, every single one of you, are an ambassador. And that is pretty significant, isn't it? And the next one, what time is it? Okay, the next one we're going to discuss tonight is that we, you and I, are seated with Jesus Christ in the heavenly realm. Really? It says so in Ephesians 2:6. It says, for he raised us from the dead along with Christ and seated us with him in the heavenly realms because we are united with Christ Jesus. Look at that. I can't imagine that, but it says it. It says, seated with Jesus, with him in the heavenly realm. And it's the present tense too. Right now, we, you and I are somehow seated with Jesus, and we will be at death as well. When you or I or we start to feel of little value, we can remember we are seated with Jesus in the heavenly realms right now. Do I fully understand this? No, I don't. Truthfully, does that change it? Nope, not at all. And here's another one that's wonderful. I pray this a lot for people, or say it. We, you and I, we are God's workmanship. He doesn't make any junk either. Ephesians 2:10, for we are Christ's masterpiece. Some versions say workmanship. He has created us anew in Christ Jesus so we can do the good things he planned for us long ago. I like that in the King James Version the best, but I didn't pull it. Oh, is it? Cool. Will we mess up? You bet. But remember, he who began a good work in each of us will continue it, that good work, until the day of Christ Jesus. And we know that because it says so in Philippians 1:6, which is one of my other favorite verses. Being confident of this very thing, that he who has begun a good work in you will complete it until the day of Christ Jesus. Good news, are you significant? Are you feeling a little more valuable? Now you have documentation for why you're valuable and significant and why you matter, because you do, and I do too. The next one is we, you and I, may approach God with freedom and confidence. Ephesians 3:12. There's this really cool song about, I'll put it in the main room later tonight. And it says, a saint is just a sinner who falls down and gets up. Who falls down and gets up. It's a really cool song. Ephesians 3:12 says, because of Christ and our faith in him, we can now come boldly and confidently into God's presence. We can come into his presence with confidence. That we are accepted, we are wanted, and we are welcome. And isn't that wonderful to think about? Do you ever feel like you're not welcome somewhere? Well, guess what? We're always welcomed by God, and we are welcomed right smack dab into his very presence. And we can do all things through Christ who strengthens us. Philippians 4:13, that means all things that God wants us to do. For I can do everything through Christ who gives me strength. Have you ever wanted to scream? Has life ever gotten to you? I bet Nanny Dove's been there in the last few days, and I was there earlier today. Have you ever wanted to scream, "I can't do this anymore"? Fact of the matter is, there are many things we honestly cannot do in our own strength. But the very good news is, we don't have to. We get His strength. And I'm closing violinist. As I wrote this and meditated on these verses, I began to feel so much better. I pray my prayer for you and for me and for all of us is that when life or people seem to toss us aside and the devil attempts to make us think we don't matter, we can remember that God does not just say we are significant. He has proven it in His word, and by His actions, and by His love. For God so loved the whole wide world, just like our song said. Father, we bless you in this night. We thank you for this reminder. I thank you for each person here, and I pray that every heart will be touched in a special way, and that each one will go with one thing that they needed to remember tonight, and that it will be something that sticks with us when the next rejection comes along, or the next "I'm not good enough" or "I don't matter" thought comes, that we can go, "Look, wait, God says." So I thank you for this time. I thank you for your word. I thank you in advance for the violinist who's going to play for us. And Lord, just have your way. Help us to live and move and have our very being in awareness that we are seated with you in heavenly places. In Jesus' name, amen. Okay, your turn. Wasn't that fun?
And everybody hear me okay? Good. My microphone's working. I'm going to go get my instrument and be right back.
Thank you, thank you, thank you, violinist.